We're so very glad that you chose to watch the live stream from the 36th Street Church of Christ in Vienna, West Virginia. We meet on Sundays at 9:30 for class, 10:30 and 6 o'clock for service on Sundays, and on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. for class. We hope that it's been encouraging. We know that watching can't compare to being with us in person, and if at all possible, we invite you to join us. We'd also love to pray for you or perhaps help in some other way. If that's possible, we'd like to encourage you to contact us by calling 304-295-9696 or contact us through our website at 36thstreetchurchofchrist.com. Have a blessed day.
Hey, welcome everyone this evening. I have a few announcements I'd like to make. Matthew Snyder's grandmother, Billy Creech, fell and broke her leg. She had surgery Monday in Morgantown. I don't have any further updates on her condition after the surgery, but she had surgery. Donna Dixon has been out with COVID. I talked to her this afternoon. She is improving. Morgan Ashcraft and her family has COVID, so keep them in your prayers. Mike Odell is not with us this evening. He is sick with laryngitis and has been to MedExpress, and they've given him an antibiotic. Maxine Wharton, who is Anita Miller's mother and Angie Miller's grandmother, passed away yesterday morning. There will be no visitation or funeral service. A private burial will be held at the family's convenience, but you still can remember them in your prayers and send them a card. Now, on Sunday, August the 14th, put this date on your calendar. After morning services, we're going to have a picnic over in the park, over in Jackson Park. Hot dogs and hamburgers and buns will be provided. We need the church members to bring side dishes, whatever you like, and drinks. The picnic is in that last shelter, the JC shelter, down near the building, clear at the back of the playground area. What's that? Yeah, in the dog park area, back in the back. Yeah. There will be activities there for the children, and the children will be singing. So if you're in attendance, you'll hear the children all. They've been practicing some songs, and they'll be singing for us as well. And I want to remind everyone, tonight is the last night for ordering clothing. So get your order forms and get your payments into Doug so that he can get an order put together and get it out. Dan Minks is taking the money, so but the forms come to Doug. So at this time, Doug is going to lead us in a prayer and introduce our speaker this evening.
So I first met our speaker back in 2016. This was the old guest book for 36th Street. It used to be in the foyer here. And you can see that on April 24th, 2016, Doug and Lori Kishore visited here. So we came here, and I remember my son brought us down. I saw some of the offices there, and I think, oh, those are pretty nice offices. And Mark was speaking, and I don't remember what you're speaking on, but yeah. And I think I met Mike Moss. I remember my wife spoke with Betty Ann Miller and Paula Garner. And so history goes back a little ways. So very, very glad of that. I know Mark doesn't really need an introduction here. So let's go to God in prayer today. Father, we know that the many prayer requests are very extensive, that we've just mentioned. We know that there are people who have experienced losses. We know that there are many who are sick and struggling. And sometimes we can feel helpless in the midst of all these things that pile upon us. And you give us the gift of each other and the fellowship that we share in your son Jesus, that we can encourage one another and build one another up. And I'm thankful, Lord, for the gifts of speech and communication, for the great heart that you gave us, made in your image, that we're able to reach out to others and encourage them and comfort them in the midst of these difficult times that we have. And I pray, Lord, that you would continue to help us to be ever mindful of our brothers and sisters and the struggles that they're facing, that we would be there continually for them as you give us opportunity. Let us not leave here and forget those things, but to bring them up to you in prayer as we go forth from here. But also, Lord, we're very thankful for a portion of your word that is able to be presented tonight. We're very thankful that Mark has made the trip back here, back home, to 36th Street, that he can present this to us. And we ask, Lord, your blessing upon his family, his ministry in Lancaster, Ohio. And I pray that you would continue to help us to continue to work together in the cause of Christ for your kingdom. It's through your son, Jesus, that we pray this and offer thanks. Amen.
Well, good evening. Good evening. Good to see you all. Thank you for letting me come be a part of your summer series. Appreciate the invitation from whoever it was that invited me. And the fact that when you saw tonight was night I was going to be here, you didn't stay away. But so good to see you. And I could lose most of my time with reminiscences and because I will say a good thing, there's people here I don't know, which is a good thing. But there's a lot of people that you're just an essential part of my life. And it's good to spend time with you. I actually got to bring three-fourths of my girls with me tonight. Only our youngest one, Maggie, has had to work late. So all three girls are working full-time. Am I allowed to tell them what you do? So Madeline, our oldest, is a medical scribe. Molly is an event coordinator for a place where you get married. I don't know if that's a good description, but that's how I say it. And Maggie is working at a daycare. She just started. Went from never working to full-time. Can't get away. So. And she's enjoying that. Tracy works in pharmacy at the hospital in Lancaster. By the way, that is the right way to say it. It's Lancaster or Lancaster. Lancaster is in Pennsylvania. And I learned that in the first days in Lancaster. But anyway, bring you greetings from your brethren there and We're doing great there, and I'm glad to see you doing so well. You've hired a great man to preach for you and minister here, and I'm really happy for you. And I heard you hired a secretary, so that's congratulations there too. So love is discipleship. Now I'm not used to clicking my own slides, so who knows how many you'll get to see. I have several, if I remember to click it, but you know, we can learn a lot about both love and discipleship from Paul's letters to Timothy. So that's where we're going to be in the text of Scripture tonight, in Paul's letters to Timothy, this younger minister that Paul both loved and discipled. You know, Paul calls Timothy, I just want to go through sort of a quick survey of the letters to Timothy in their references to Timothy, okay? Paul calls Timothy my true child in the faith, right in the opening verses of 1 Timothy. He again calls him my child in verse 18 of chapter 1 of 1 Timothy. And then he shows concern not only for his spiritual well-being, but also his physical. If you go over chapter 5, verse 23 of 1 Timothy, you'll notice that Paul is concerned about Timothy's health. He refers to Timothy as a man of God in chapter 6, verse 11. And then in the second letter, once again in the opening verses, Paul calls Timothy my beloved child. And he tells him soon after that that he thanks God for him and that he prays for him constantly. He says in chapter 1, verse 4 of 2 Timothy, he longs to see him and that seeing him would fill him with joy. And then he remembers how important members of Timothy's family were in his development. So he mentions his mother Eunice, his grandmother Lois. Chapter 2, verse 1 of 2 Timothy, he calls him again, my child. And then in chapter 4, verse 9, he expresses his desire that Timothy would come and visit him. And Paul's in prison when he asks Timothy to come see him. So you have this relationship. There's obviously great love between Paul and Timothy. And then even outside of these two letters of Paul to Timothy, we have things like this in the letter to the Philippians. Chapter 2, verse 19, it says, Paul writes, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, so that I too may be cheered by news of you. And listen to how he describes him. He says, for I have no one like him who will be genuinely concerned for your welfare. They all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ, but you know Timothy's proven worth, how as a son with a father he has served with me in the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him just as soon as I see how it will go with me. So even when Paul is writing to other churches, not to Timothy, he's singing his praises. And then to the Corinthians, Paul calls Timothy my beloved and faithful child in the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. And then if you just look at all of Paul's letters, just the opening line, you will see that Timothy is often co-author of these letters that Paul wrote. And so they have a close, unique bond, a special relationship. It was certainly based on mutual love. Hey, I got it. Mutual love, and it was forged through the work of discipleship. Paul discipled Timothy. And I'm sure as time went on, there were moments when Timothy discipled Paul. But what does that mean? To be a disciple, what is a disciple and what does it mean to disciple someone else? That's really the meat of our study this evening. Before we answer that, let me say a couple of things about it. You know, our churches, and by that I mean churches of Christ, in the Romans 16:16 sense, churches of Christ. The churches of Christ salute you. You remember, it says there. Our churches have had a troubling history, at least in modern times, of discipleship. So I can remember when I was very young, a discipling movement arose in portions of the church in the 60s and 70s that was an aberration. In fact, it became very much like a cult and met almost all the marks of a cult. And eventually it broke away from mainline churches, if you want to call us that, and went its own way, and now they're known as the International Churches of Christ. They talked a lot about discipleship. They practiced discipling in very controlling, legalistic ways, frankly, and In fact, in ways that were so controlling, they got kicked off of most major university campuses in the United States at the time. Just earned a terrible reputation for themselves and didn't help us out, since they carried the name Church of Christ. That kind of thing is not what I'm talking about when I use this terminology, okay? I've also noticed in recent years, more and more talk about discipleship in the brotherhood. And there's a lot of people writing about it and conducting workshops and offering seminars and so forth, how to disciple. And the jury is still out, I believe, on these modern discipling movements. I see some good things from them, and I see some possibly troubling things. We'll see in time. I'm not talking about that. That's not where I'm coming from either. Because my fear, you see, is that we make discipleship and discipling too complex. We make it too intricate, too programmed. I'm not interested in a discipleship program that's more involved than the one we see Jesus conduct, or that we see in the example of Paul and Timothy. I'm not interested in anything beyond that, as far as what I want to teach and be about. You see, it's not hard at all to define what a disciple is. And it's not all that complex to describe how one goes about discipling another person. It's really basic and simple. So simple, in fact, that if you go about it this way, no one is likely to ask you to write a book about it, or to conduct a seminar, or invite you to a big lectureship to speak about it. Because really, the book's already been written that teaches about it and teaches how to do it. So, you know, if you teach it this way, you're not going to get famous, and you're not going to fill your schedule conducting seminars about it. I'm just a little suspicious when people try to make the Bible more complex than it actually is. That's just me. Okay. So, what is a disciple? Still working. Good. Simple definition of a disciple is a person who is becoming like Jesus. Can you remember that? Get that? A disciple is a person who is becoming like Jesus. In our context, well, we're talking about Christianity. Okay, there's disciples in other things as well. But for our definition, a disciple is a person who is becoming like Jesus. And then, what does it mean to disciple someone? Well, I don't want to disappoint you, but it's no harder. To disciple is to help someone become like Jesus. That's what it is. That's the biblical description of it. That's what it means. So that's not revolutionary. But maybe what I'm about to say might be a little bit more so for us. I'm convinced that the business of the church is making disciples. Why do I believe that? Because I heard it at a lectureship someplace? No. Or read it in a book? No. Unless the book is this book. Now, I learned this from Jesus. Matthew 28, verse 19. You remember what the Lord said? Go make disciples. Go therefore make disciples of all nations. Jesus' last words to his disciples that he had trained before he left this earth and ascended to the right hand of God on high was go make disciples. For me, that's good enough authority as far as what we're supposed to be doing. what our business is. Our business is making disciples. We're in the disciple-making business. So I want to ask us tonight, how's business? Now notice, I want to be very specific. I did not say our business was baptizing. Now my, that is a strange thing for a Church of Christ preacher to say, correct? All right, so should I explain myself? Yeah. But you see, I'm just quoting the one that we're named after, the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. He did not say, go baptize people. Now, as you know, because I know most of you, he goes on in verse 19 and tells us what we are eventually to do with disciples. What is it? We baptize them, right? We baptize disciples. We teach them also to observe all things that Jesus commanded. Is that correct? Matthew 28, 19. Make disciples, baptizing them, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded. Okay. All people who are becoming like Jesus. And again, that's our simple definition of a disciple tonight. Someone who's becoming like Jesus. All people who are becoming like Jesus are eventually baptized. And in fact, they're not right with God. They're not forgiven of their sins. They're not washed in the blood of Jesus. They're not saved until they are baptized. Would you agree? Amen? Okay. Just want to make sure you knew I was on the same page with you. But you see, when you first start working with a person, you meet somebody and you're like, I think there's potential there. I want to influence them, teach them. When you first start working with that person, first start helping them become like Jesus, it does no good at all to dunk them in a baptistry until they understand they need to do that. Does it? Is the water magic? No. So we don't immediately baptize somebody. Wouldn't that be great? Just go down to Walmart and meet somebody and just dunk them right away, you know? Would that do them any good? No. It might do you some bad. Okay? Does no good to do that. So yes, all true disciples will eventually be baptized, but the business of the church is to make disciples. That's our business according to Jesus. And again, I ask the question, how's business? And then after they're baptized, they still need to become more like Jesus, don't they? They still need discipled. And here's what I think part of our problem in the church throughout history has been is that thinking, well, we got them immersed, they're good to go, and I can move on to the next sinner. Well, we know that's not wise, that's not true, and that's not biblical. I've been a Christian now for 39 years, and I still need to become more like Jesus. Just ask Tracy. She can give you an example from today, I'm sure. I still need to be discipled. Discipling is helping someone become more like Jesus. All right? I still need that. Discipleship is a lifelong process. And I think what happens sometimes in our churches is we get discouraged when we don't see consistent baptisms, when we haven't been using the baptistry as much as we'd like. But instead, we ought to be concerned when no one's becoming more like Jesus. That ought to be the flashing red warning light. When no one's becoming more like Jesus, and see, there's no way to put a number on the board back there about how many became more like Jesus this day or that day, you see. But our business is making disciples. How's business? Why are we in the business of making disciples? Because Jesus commissioned us to do it. Why did he do that? Well, that's where we get back to our theme for this evening. Love is discipleship. John 3:16. You've known it all your life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Why did God send his Son? God sent his Son because God loved the world. When his Son came here, what did his Son do? Well, a big part of what he did was make disciples. He called them. He walked with them. He talked with them. He trained them. He rebuked them. He showed them a good example of things. He sent them on missions. Sometimes he went. Sometimes he sent them separate from himself. And we can go on and on with examples. For 3.5 years, right? Jesus makes disciples. See, he never asks us to do things he doesn't do. So it's not surprising that just before he leaves the world, he says to these disciples, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." The business of disciples of Jesus is making disciples. That is, helping people become more like Jesus. How's business? I think we need to start finding a way of evaluating our effectiveness as churches and as Christians by Jesus' standards. We need to retrain our minds in this. Not how many baptisms have we had, not how many were at church on Sunday, not how many programs are running, not how good the music is, none of those things. How many people are becoming more like Jesus? How many disciples are being made? How many people am I discipling? Because that, I cannot pawn off on the preacher. Now, he needs to be doing it, but I need to be doing it. Because I'm a disciple. This is our business. How's business? So Paul was a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, did Paul have anybody he was discipling? Anybody he was helping become more like Jesus? Well, of course he did. Many, but none more prominent in the New Testament than Timothy. Why did he spend so much time with this Timothy? Well, because he loved Timothy. We went through all the references at the beginning. Over and over, he reiterates his love, his fatherly love, his pride in Timothy. He sings Timothy's praises. Why does he spend so much time on this guy? Because he loved him. Love is discipleship. We think of love in the letters of Paul. This is a big part of it. All those names. We have famous ones like Timothy. But there's a lot of names. Sometimes just go count up all the names that come up in Paul's letter. We don't know anything about other than that he named them. What was he doing with those folks? Helping them become more like Jesus. Discipling them. To one degree or another. Look at a couple of passages with me that just sort of reflect this discipling relationship between Paul and Timothy. I'm going to cheat and go into 2 Timothy for a minute, because I know that's next Wednesday night. But don't tell anybody that I did that. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10. Paul writes, "But you," speaking to Timothy, "you have followed my teaching, my conduct, my purpose, my faith, my patience, my love and endurance, along with the persecutions and sufferings that came to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from them all. In fact, all those who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." If you really look at those three verses, every single word drips with discipleship. You know, it's like he's saying, here, Timothy, is what it's like to be a disciple of Jesus. Here's what it's like to be more like Jesus. You've watched me do it. Now you go do it. Right? Then just go in reverse, one chapter, chapter 2, 2 Timothy, beginning of that chapter. He says, "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." What is Paul calling Timothy to do? Well, it's just the self-same thing that Jesus called all of us to do in Matthew 28:19. Make disciples. Our business is disciple-making. How's business? Now, discipleship is obviously a big topic. It was interesting, as I was studying, I just searched that word disciple or discipleship or discipling or something like that. Only occurs in 5 books in the New Testament. I was really surprised at that. The 4 Gospels and Acts. You won't find this word in any of the letters or in Revelation. And I don't know what to make of that, but it was an interesting note, but heavy in the Gospels because that's what Jesus is doing. But anyway, it's a big topic as far as how it's done, and we haven't talked so much about the nuts and bolts of it tonight, but it's really not that complex or hard to understand. There are a lot of things to do, but they're all things that you've read in Scripture all your life. All right? Things about being godly, things that help you become more like Jesus, studying the Word of God, praying, worshiping, serving, go on and on with the list of sort of discipleship activities. The question is, are we helping others do this? If I ask you tonight, and I mean you, when I say you, I mean you personally, all right? If I ask you, who are you discipling? Do faces come to mind? If I ask you, who is discipling you? Now, let's go back. What is our definition of a disciple? You can talk. No, I've been talking about it. A disciple is someone becoming like Jesus. All right. And to disciple someone is to help them do what? Wow, this is hard stuff, isn't it? If I ask who's discipling you, that is, who's helping you become more like Jesus, who do you think of? Well, there's probably several, isn't there? I hope there is. Because that's our business as disciples of Christ and as a church. How's business? when we moved to Lancaster, I started preaching to the church there. Having been here for 25 years, I had all these great stories to tell them about you folks, about the church here, and about some of you individuals. I always changed the names to protect the guilty. All right? But tonight, I'm in reverse. I can tell you some stories about that. All right? Just as illustrations. And if we have some time, I may ask you for some. So, I look at people here tonight that back through the years, I helped disciple. I didn't tell you I was doing that. Okay? But hopefully, just in hearing preaching and teaching, I mean, some of that happens, but there's a degree of this, it has to be one-on-one too, like Paul with Timothy. Okay? So I see people that I discipled, and I see an awful lot of people that discipled me. Helped me become more like Jesus. One of the main ones sitting right there, who trained me how to love a church. I didn't know how to do that. I knew how to translate Greek and Hebrew when I moved here, but I didn't know how to love a church. Tom did, and he was gracious enough to share it with me and to drag me with him to see how to do it. That's discipling. There's all kinds of discipling, you see. So in the church that I'm blessed to preach for now, I can think of a couple of examples. There's a couple of young boys there. One doesn't have a father at home. And he just needs Christian male to give him attention and encourage him. Now, I don't spend 24 hours a day with him, but every time I see him, I try to do that. That's one way I'm discipled. I've never told him, I better change his name. I never told him, Frank, I'm discipling you. It's not what we're talking about, silly stuff like that. I just do it. There's another boy in the church who's pretty new. They came to us during the pandemic from another congregation. Has a great mom and dad, great grandma and grandpa, raised in church, very talented, sharp kid, loves to get up front, you know, and read scripture for us and things like that. And I'll be doggone if I'm not going to make sure he becomes a preacher. And I tell him every week, you have your sermon ready. I'm not quite ready today. Can you step in there? And so we have this fun interchange, but I'm planting that in him. I want him, because he has the ability. See, it's the way I'm discipling. He may not become a preacher, because I don't know everything. See, but that's what I'm trying to do with him. Outside of my discipling, I think there's a chain of women in the church there. One of them is an elder's wife. She's been there a long time. And years ago, I'd say within the last decades at some point, she met this woman in the congregation. I'm not even going to do the names because I know I'm going to say their name and I'll be in trouble. But so I'll just anonymous names. She met this lady and worked with her. This lady had come out of Seventh-day Adventist, or Jehovah's Witness? Jehovah's Witnesses. She had come out as Jehovah's Witness. Born and raised in it, had a terrible abusive experience, and so had come out of it, but was totally lost what to do next. And she met this elder's wife of ours, who took her in. She did not bring her to the building the next day and baptize her. But she may have been able to do that, because this lady at the time was totally easily manipulated. She had been her whole life. She just worked with her for a long time. And eventually she was baptized. She is one of our most faithful disciples in the church. If you were ever there, I'm sure you'd meet her. And forever in a Bible class situation, you'd hear her. Okay, very involved. And guess what she's doing now? She met a lady that come into the church a few years back, and she's just encouraging her. And when you talk to these ladies, you know who they talk about? Well, so-and-so says, or she said to me about this, and it's just good. It's like three generations, and they're all about the same age. Doesn't matter about age, see? It's just this one helped this one become more like Jesus. Eventually, she became a Christian. This one's helping this one become more like Jesus. I'm just waiting for this one. That's what we're talking about, okay? And I think we would be better off in the church in general if we evaluated how business is by how many people are becoming more like the Lord. Not how many people did we put under there, although we're going to put them under there at some point, or not how many is on that board back there. The business of the church is making disciples. And you're probably sick of hearing this question tonight. How is business? Got a few minutes, I think. Do I have like 5 minutes? Is it 5, 7 minutes? Something like that. I thought I'd stop a minute and just maybe somebody wants to share an example of someone who has helped them become more like Jesus. Maybe in the dim mists of time, or maybe more recently. Anybody want to offer something like that? I think this is something we should be comfortable talking about. So talk. I'll just start telling stories about you all. Go ahead.
As my wife passed, there were several cards, letters that were given to me, different people talking about the impact that she had made on their lives. Even people who were in the music teaching world, maybe they were students, maybe they were fellow teachers, but they could speak to a conversation that had happened, or perhaps something that was said. Maybe they were going through a rough time, and she took them aside, studied with them a little bit. Always unofficial because you're in a school setting or something, but. Right. It was always something that really made an impact and helped out. I know there was an older student that she had that, they had a single mom, but there was no dad in the picture, and these kids didn't have much at all. And but yet the older kids would be helping at a younger kid's concert or something like that. And I know she would, say to me, run out and grab however money, McDonald's or whatever, bring it back. And it was maybe the only food they had all day to be able to share. But she wanted to pay her help, that kind of thing.
It can be just sharing a meal or a cup of water. Isn't that in the scripture? One who shares such in my name. There were a couple of names. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Bob.
Father.
Who that was?
He was a Baptist for how many years?
Years.
And then dad just adopted him like a brother. I mean, a son. And,
like a brother. Yeah. Yeah.
26 years ago, you baptized.
I know. I didn't know it was 26 years, man.
Yeah. We're getting old.
We are. Yep. I heard a couple of names mentioned earlier. I think Doug mentioned Betty Miller and Paula Garner. That was you that mentioned them, right? Now, this can be a fun experiment. How many of you were helped to become more like Jesus by either or both Betty Miller, Paula Garner? And unless you're new here, I better see every hand go up. See, it doesn't matter if you're guy or girl. She helped me become a better disciple, more like Jesus. I think I helped her. And you all, I mean, if I opened it up, tell me how Betty or Paula did that. What time do the lights go out here? Lots of examples. Anybody else want to share one?
Back close to 30 years ago, I was teaching an adult class, and I looked up on the subject, but it had to do with street people and how they hung out under the Ann Street Bridge downtown. It had a little cardboard sign, not as big as a cereal box, you couldn't read it, but they had this little sign that says, "We'll work." And I started asking questions in class that morning about that. And the question evolved and came around to why don't we do more to help those people? Why do we look the other way? Pretend like they're not there. Now, I was guilty of sin about that. I mean, I really was, because I wanted to help, but I was in a hurry. I had a Bible study someplace, you know, or something wrong. And so I wasn't able to be where I wanted to be. But I asked the congregation that morning, I said, what could I have done? What would you do? And one of the guys here, who's not here tonight, but he's here most of the time, spoke up. He said, "Tom, why don't you go around the block, get him a Big Mac and a small Coke, and come back under the bridge and get his attention. Do that for him." I hadn't done that. I had not done that regularly, but I did after that.
Yeah.
He got my attention. He was discipling me.
Yes.
It didn't take that long, did it? It wasn't that complex. He didn't have to read 10 chapters in the Bible to you.
It felt so good to make it sure.
Yeah. This is our business. This is really what... You get what I'm saying about we sort of have the wrong measures in mind when we think about how's the church doing. We have the wrong measures in mind because not every person you disciple will be baptized, because they're going to make their own choice. But and many baptized people need a lot of discipling after, for the rest of their life, which Tom just gave an example of. And I just reiterate how much he trained me. Yes?
I remember you 20-some years ago.
Can we leave the years out?
Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
I was 40 years old, never raised in the church, and you pretty much had to get me from scratch. And I remember the workbooks you gave me to kind of help me through all that beginning stuff and the one-on-one teaching. So, but that, you know, out here, I was, like I said, I never raised in the church, 40 years old. Pretty much had to get me from scratch.
Sometimes it involves a study like that.
Right.
That's part of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Good. I'm glad. But see, sometimes people will say, "I can't do this because I don't have the ability to sit down with an intimidating guy like that and study." You don't have to do that. You just have to be part of the process of making them more like Jesus, using your whatever your gift or talent is. Right? Just getting warmed up, and I'm over time, so I'll be obedient and be quiet. But
Paul preached at midnight. It's biblical.
That's true. I don't want anybody falling out the window, though, because I don't have the ability to raise them. Thank you again for letting me be here and for listening and participating. So tonight, maybe there's somebody that needs encouragement, prayers of the congregation here, or help along the path of discipleship, whatever it might be, or maybe somebody's ready tonight even to get on that path, to say, yes to Jesus, I will obey, I will be baptized into Christ tonight. If that's where you are, wherever it is, if we can help you in some way, just let us know how. Let's stand and sing with Doug.
Who will follow Jesus standing on the right, holding up his banner in the thickest fight, listen for his orders, ready to obey? Who will follow Jesus serving him today? Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus in life's busy place, working for the Master, giving him the praise, earnest in his vineyard, honoring his laws, faithful to his counsel, watchful for his cause? Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus when the tempter charms? Flee then for safety to the Savior's arms, trusting in his mercy, trusting in his power, seeking fresh renewals of his grace each hour. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus in his work above, leading others to him, lifting prayers above? Courage, faithful servant, in his word we see, on our side forever will the Savior be. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I. Who will follow Jesus? Who will make reply? I am on the Lord's side, Master, here am I.
Thank you, everybody, for being able to come tonight. I think that's a very powerful message that we need to hear.
Amen.
Something that is very pertinent in today's culture, a culture that has drifted away from God's word and struggles with the idea or concept of organized religion. But we are to teach others to become more like Jesus. That's our our goal. That's our mission. That's our work that we're doing, our business, as Mark said over and over again. So let's go to him in prayer this evening, and let's ask him to be able to help us in that work. Father, we're cut to the heart in realizing that our business is going and making disciples. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to recognize every moment of every day as an opportunity to work with somebody, to have a conversation with somebody, to bring somebody closer to Jesus than they were
before we talk with them, before we interact with them, help them in whatever way that you have put before us. You give us those opportunities all the time, Lord. It might be in line at a store, it might be in an aisle there, it might be at work, it might be in our neighborhoods as we go out and get our mail and interact with a neighbor. Father, I pray that you would truly help us to see those around us as folks who need to become more like you, as we ourselves need to become more like you. Help us to become like Jesus, and help us to help others to become like him as well. It's through our Savior that we offer this prayer.
I hope that the message today was very encouraging to you, and that you will find something in it that will help you in your relationship with God. We'd love to pray for you, or perhaps help in some other way. And if this is a need of yours, we'd ask you, please contact us at 304-295-9696 or through our website, 36thstreetchurchofchrist.com. And a minister, myself, or someone else would be glad to spend some time with you in study and prayer.